let's take a look at some of the folder structure and let's take a look at the folder structure within Redwood.js and some of the features and opinions that make Redwood, Redwood. If you're new to the Self Teach Me channel, my name is Amy Dutton. I'm a web designer and developer, and I want to help you level up and get to where you want to be. So if this sounds interesting to you, hit the subscribe button below. This video is part of a multi-part series on building a Hacker News clone within Redwood, and I'll include links to the previous videos within the description below. So far, we've gotten our project up and running with a fresh install of Redwood, and I'll include a link to my code on GitHub if you want to jump in. Now, I'm going to pull up our project within VS Code so that we can walk through the folder structure together. Now, don't feel like you have to remember all the things. These pieces will make much more sense once we actually start writing code, but at least you'll have an overview before we dive into the nitty-gritty. At the top, you'll notice a few dot folders. These include preferences and cache files and folders. You can ignore these. They're needed, but we won't actively work inside them. The first real folder that we have is our API folder, and this folder contains the backend of our project. So Redwood is a true full stack framework. So other frameworks, Next and Remix, might give you an API, but they don't have a GraphQL server running complete with serverless functions. Inside the DB folder, you'll find a schema.prisma file, and this is where we'll define our database models for Prisma. Inside the source directory, we have several folders. So the directives folder allows us to set up directives for working with our GraphQL schema. In fact, if you open up this directory, you'll find two directives that we get out of the box, require auth and skip auth. And these allow us to protect our GraphQL queries and mutations specifying access. Next up, we have our functions directory. And this is where our serverless functions live. So if you open this folder, you'll find a function for working with GraphQL. Now, the next folder is our GraphQL folder. And right now, this directory is empty, but this is where we'll eventually generate some SDL files that will define our GraphQL queries and mutations. Now, our lib folder, or our library directory here, contains some helper functions for working with auth, our database, and our logger. And the last directory in our source directory is our services. And this is where we'll set up resolvers for working with GraphQL, and we'll include Prisma API calls for creating, reading, updating, and deleting our data. Then to round off our API directory here, we have some configuration files. We have a jest config for testing, a package.json file for our API directory, a server config, and a TypeScript config. Then moving along to the next folder, we have our node modules. And this is where all of the dependencies from our project automatically get downloaded and saved inside this directory. Then we have our scripts directory. And as you might assume, this includes any custom scripts for our project. So out of the box, we have a script for seeding our database. And spoiler alert, we'll create a custom script for building an SVG sprite that will stick inside this directory. Now, moving along again, we have our web folder. And this includes our project's front end. Nested inside, we have a public directory. So anything that gets added to this folder automatically gets compiled and sent to the browser. So out of the box, we have a favicon, we have a readme explaining how this folder works, and we also have a robots.txt file. So other things that I will stick into this directory, most of the projects that you'll work on will have an images directory, and that can be accessed as if it's in the root of your website. So for example, my image could be referenced as /images/myimage.png. Now I've also stuck a fonts folder here. So if I want to use a custom font and implement it in CSS with @fontface, that could go in here. Next up, we have our source directory, and this is where you'll probably spend a bulk of your time. Inside, there's a components directory for all of our React components. There's a layouts directory for your layout components and a page folder for any site pages. Now our app, an entry client, and index.html files are used to build the application. I actually don't touch these. Now our index.css is perfect for including our site CSS. For our project, we'll add Tailwind, and we'll still use this file for accessing Tailwind's layers and creating custom styles to use in multiple places throughout our project. Then last, but definitely not least, is our routes.tsx file. And this is one of those things that makes Redwood, Redwood. Most other frameworks rely on a file or a folder structure, meaning if you add a file or a folder called about, then you have a route/about. Redwood, on the other hand, relies on this routes.tsx file. And inside, it lists out all the routes within our project. So this might take some getting used to, but at the end of the day, it's really an eloquent solution, especially as your project grows. You're not digging through folders looking for a specific route. Plus, it allows you to easily rename and remap paths or URLs without reorganizing your code. And if you're coming from a Rails background, this pattern probably looks very familiar. Now, the last set of files within our web directory here are configuration files. We have another Jest file for setting up testing on the front end. We have our package.json for our web directory, and we have a TypeScript file and a Vite file. And that does it for our web directory. Now, there are just a handful of files that are left. There are several .env files. So all of your project's environmental variables and secrets will live inside of your .env file. And this is listed inside of your .gitignore file so that it won't be committed to your repo. But you may want to define some default environmental variables within your .env.defaults or provide a list of all the environmental variables that you'll need within your .env.example file. Both of these files are especially useful when you're working with a team. Next up, we have our .gitignore file. I already mentioned this file, but this lists any files or folders that Git should ignore. Then finally, we have a few more settings files, one for Node, for Yarn, GraphQL, Jest testing, our projects package.json file, our prettier config, our projects readme, Redwood specific settings, and then a yarn.lock file. So even though we've made it all the way through all of the files and folders, I did want to take a quick step back and point out one thing, connecting a few dots. So you may have noticed that there are three package.json files within our project. There's one within the root of our project. There's also one within our API directory. And then there's also one here within our web directory. Within Redwood, we're using Yarn workspaces to manage the two sides, our website and our API side. So if you want to add a new package to the website, you'll need to specify that particular workspace. So for example, I would say Yarn workspace web to add it to the front end, add date functions. Or if we wanted to add date functions to the API side, you'd change this to API. Cool. I don't know about you, but I'm ready to start writing some code, stubbing out our pages, and building some components. And Redwood has some built-in generators that make this process easy peasy. So in the next video, we'll create files for all of our routes and at least most of our layouts and components. As a quick recap, in this video, we walked through all the files and folders that Redwood gives us with a fresh install. And again, these will make even more sense as we dive in and get our hands dirty. Be sure to hit the subscribe button below and click the bell icon so you get notifications when new videos are posted. I'll catch you there.